Triple J is celebrating the 20th anniversary of Nirvana's Nevermind, an album from Kurt Cobain, Krist Novoselic and Dave Grohl. Krist Novoselic spoke to Tom and Alex about that game-changing record.
Hey, Tom. Hey, Alex. How you doing?
We're really well, thanks, Krist. And we appreciate your time so much. We know you're only doing a couple of interviews on this very very important occasion in the history of music. So thanks very much for talking to Triple J. Looking back now, we're 20 years on. Looking back at Nevermind, Alex and I were 2 and 3, respectively,
yep,
when this album was released.
We only get to, yeah, see the music through through the legacy. Yeah. Not
I was
the time.
Playing bass. You guys were in your diapers.
That's exactly the hours. Yeah, yes.
That's true.
I walked 10 miles to band practice with a 50-pound pack on my back. It was like,
right,
do I sound like a geezer?
Yeah, that's geezer. That's great. We do technically call
them. I'm a geezer.
Got a great geezer there, Krist.
Hey, thanks.
Still a geezer.
I guess.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So talking to two guys who were just kids, who were under 5 when this whole thing was released, and when you guys blew up and sold millions and millions of copies of this record, can you try and give us just a sense of what it was like for you at that time in the early 90s when Nirvana released Nevermind?
Did you get that exhale over the phone, like, oh, God? Well, it was the being in that. How do I explain it? Okay, it was Nirvana was big from like 91 to 94. Okay, and then when I look back at that time, I can't believe it was like 3 years, and it just seems like so much was going on, and things were so compressed and so intense, and it was the biggest thing that ever happened to me. So you know, it was pretty wild ride. But there are a lot of blessings that came out of Nirvana. You know, and you look into it, the music, it just boils down to the music. So I guess, you know, Dave and Kurt and I, we played well together. We liked to rock. We knew a lot about music. And we arranged these songs. Kurt wrote these great songs. And we have this record, Nevermind, among other works.
Does it feel like another time? Is it hard to think about that 20 years as, you know, 20 linear years? Do you feel like it's that time has gone quickly for you, or is it hard to remember that early time, the early 90s?
Yes and no. It's, you know, 20 years seems like went by fast, but people walk up to me every day. Not every day, but when, you know, I live out kind of remote. I'm kind of a recluse in some ways, but you know, people tell me, you know, they'll tell me like, oh, you know, thanks for Nevermind, or thanks for the music, and Nirvana's music means so much to me and it changed my life, and I'm really grateful for that. First of all, because I experienced that, because I know that I've had that same experience when I listen to bands like, you know, Black Sabbath, Black Flag, Flipper, Beatles, and how much that music meant to me. So I've had that same experience that people share with me. And second of all, that's a way for me to chalk one up for Kurt, you know, because he was such a committed, compelled artist, and he was so driven to express himself. And when people say, hey, man, Nirvana changed my life, and I'm just like, kind of look up in the sky and say, that one's for you, dude.
Krist Novoselic of Nirvana, speaking to Tom and Alex on Triple J, celebrating 20 years of Nevermind. Hear the full interview at triplej.net.au.
Do you think that Kurt, at the time of the recording of Nevermind, knew that this was going to be the definitive record for you guys, and this was going to mean so much and was going to be coming at such an important time in music history, do you think, when you guys were recording?
I don't think anybody did. You know, the record label in the United States printed 40,000 copies, and that was going to be like indie gold, right? And so we release Nevermind, and we get this video, Smells Like Teen Spirit, on heavy rotation on MTV in America. We were getting picked up by FM radio, who are like starting to change their format to this like alternative format and this and that, okay? And so there's a phenomenon, like the song is a big hit, and so people want to go buy this CD from this band Nirvana, and they go to the record store, and it's out, and they'd have to wait for weeks to buy it. And so that just added to the phenomenon, the mystique, like, why you can't even buy that record, you know?
Supply and demand.
Yeah, supply and demand. So maybe people were like, I'll sell you my copy. Yeah, and I was on the corner selling my copies for like $100.
Scalping them.
All right, I got some Neverminds here. You want some You got one of those jackets? You open those. I got a few Neverminds here for you, mate.
What a scumbag.
Does the nostalgia around Nirvana and Nevermind, does that make it hard for you, Chris, to live every day sort of in the moment, day to day?
No, it doesn't, because I don't allow to. Well, first of all, I am grateful that so many people care about Nirvana and that the music has so much meaning, you know? And then people are still buying the CDs, and I get to do interviews on cool radio stations like Triple J with Tom and Alex. You know what I mean? So the nostalgia is not bothering me. Not that I'm necessarily nostalgic. I mean, I can be about things, and I have my own life, and I try to live in the moment. So I'm just, you know, it's a blessing that people still care. Come as you are, as you
were, as I want you to be. You're on Triple J. We're talking to Chris Novoselic from Nirvana, the bassist thereof, and on this 20th anniversary of Nirvana's Nevermind, the release of that in 1991. Chris, can I ask you about your relationship with Australia? Obviously, there's so much love for you in this country. And there was this really interesting thing where you were booked to come out and tour Australia before Nevermind broke. So by the time you came here, everybody knew you and you were the band of the moment and people loved you. I'd really love to know, what was it like for you to come into this country and have that kind of reception and have people just going nuts in this country on the other side of the world, which I assumed you'd never visited before?
Yeah, it was really exciting, and Australia was neat. There's no language barrier, and there's like cultural similarities to the United States. And so it was a comfortable place to be. And of course, the natural beauty, the climate, and it's a laid back place. I had a pretty good time. And then, yeah, Nirvana Mania, that's always a blast. We played in Canberra. I think it was at a school. and it was nuts. And that people were rushing the hall. I think it was like in the student union. And there was like this plate glass window and it broke and people were pressing against it. It was nuts.
Do you think it was bigger than Beatlemania?
Probably not. I mean, Beatlemania is the seminal...
The seminal mania.
Yeah, that's the seminal mania. That's all mania comes from Beatlemania.
Obviously, right now, we respect Nevermind so much, and we talk about how much influence it's had, and people regularly voted as the greatest record ever released. But some people at the time were not crazy in favour of it. I have a review here. A reviewer saying that most of Nevermind is packed with generic punk pop that have been done by countless acts from Iggy Pop to the Red Hot Chili Peppers, and added that the band has little or nothing to say, settling for moronic ramblings by singer-lyricist Cobain. Do you think that reviewer is kicking himself now?
Well, you know, in some ways, you know, hearing that, well, first of all, it's not moronic rambling. I mean, those are excellent lyrics from an insightful person, so I completely disagree with that. But as far as the music goes, it's like, you know, you can hear our influences. We came out of American hardcore music, the punk rock scene in the late 80s, but, you know, in the 70s there was punk rock. Of course, Iggy, even they're acknowledging Iggy, who's the godfather of punk rock and who doesn't get nearly as much credit as he should for his influence on rock and roll in general. And, you know, the 60s, and you mentioned the Beatles earlier. I mean, it's just kind of a grab bag. We have had a knowledge of music in Nirvana. Like, we were big music fans. We weren't doctrinaire punks. You know, there were hardcore music in America where people became punks and they smashed all their Led Zeppelin records. And we're like, well, this is good music. And so is Black Flag. I mean, you know what I mean? It's all just music. We like country music and, you know, maybe not very big polka fans or you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But we had, you know, we kind of had this breadth of knowledge about music, and it shows, you know, we... Cheap Trick, what did Kurt say about Nirvana? It's Cheap Trick meets Black Sabbath or something, you know?
That's nice. That's perfectly perfectly fine company to be in, I think.
And there's plenty of music on this, the Nevermind 20th anniversary edition CD, four CDs and a DVD, with plenty of B-sides and a DVD of live performances, a few different mixes in there as well. Have you had a chance to listen to any of these things, and they bring back memories
absolutely.
From a few of the lesser-known songs and moments from Nirvana?
Absolutely. I was listening to it, helping putting it together. We were listening to the mixes of the live show. I'm really excited about the DVD, the Paramount show. It's on. It was filmed. It's on film and you know, the recording, we remixed it. Sounds great. It looks great. So, you know, there's the Butch Vig version of Nevermind, different mixes. There's the original Nevermind with Chad Channing on drums, a boombox demo. So it's kind of a perspective of how Nevermind came together. So, you know, people are going to be paying their hard-earned money for this package, this anniversary package. So I wanted it to be really good. And so, you know, you pop that DVD in your entertainment system and relax and catch a great show, you know?
And you're actually doing a bit of a fundraiser, Chris, pretty soon, playing the songs of Nirvana. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Well, I was invited to the EMP. There's this exhibit called Taking Punk to the Masses, and it features artifacts and the story of Nirvana and Pacific Northwest music. And it's a great museum. It was designed by Frank Gehry. It looks like a smashed guitar. I think it's really compelling and fitting for Nirvana, right?
Yeah,
okay, so 20 years ago, we had our record release party in Seattle for Nevermind, and which Nirvana, we were kicked out of our own party because we got too rowdy, okay? And that was organized by this woman, Susie Tennant, who was the label representative in Seattle. And so, well, unfortunately, she's having some health issues, and this is a benefit show to help her with her medical expenses. And so they wanted to have some kind of event. And when they told me that it was a benefit for Susie, I'm like, absolutely, I'm going to be there. And so I'm going to play a song. And they asked me to not give out too many details. So I'm going to play a song with a band and, you know, try to have as much fun as possible. There's going to be other Seattle bands and other bands playing a song off Nevermind. So, it's
so that's what we're getting? Chris is going to play a song on a stage?
I'm going to play a song.
We can lock that in. Okay, great.
Fantastic. Yeah, getting all the scoops.
That's all I can give you. I was sworn to secrecy.
Yeah, okay. Fair enough. But it will be very exciting whenever you do that. Have you played much of the Nevermind stuff over the last 20 years? Is it tough to go back to? Yeah. Oh. Do you enjoy doing it on the bass there?
Well, that's a good question, because last weekend I was invited by the presidents of the United States of America to play a couple songs at the Southwest Washington Fair. So I went to like a county fair. And the presidents are a great band, and I played with them before. They're like fun, and you know, they're just easy, you know, easy going dudes.
Oh, sorry, I thought you meant Barack Obama.
Peaches.
The original president.
No, that's Dave.
Okay,
right. Dave sent me this picture. Okay, Dave sent me this picture of him playing at the White House, and you see the back of Obama's head and Paul McCartney's head. Like, they're watching Dave. Like, right in the and the caption is, craziest front row ever. That's the caption. It's like right off his iPhone. You know what I mean? And I'm like, whoa. No, when my presidents of the United States are just as beloved to me, the Seattle band. And so we played On a Plane and Stay Away. So it was, you know, and like I was getting ready to go on stage, and I had this kind of, it was emotional for me, and I was thinking about a lot of things, good things, bad things. My mind wandered. I got into their into their set, you know. Just kind of those things. But I got up there and I got into it and like, wow, this is great. And the audience loved it, so.
That's fantastic.
They seemed to. And then you can watch, there's like YouTube videos on all these cell phone cameras. There's like 10 of them. So if you ever want to.
I'm going to type that in right now, Chris.
Okay. Yeah. Alex, have a look at that. Chris, thank you so much for your time. Triple J really appreciates you talking to us in one of these few interviews you're doing on this, the 20th anniversary of the release of Nevermind by Nirvana. Can we just ask you finally, in the 20 years since Nevermind was released in 1991, do you think there have been any other albums that we'll still be talking about 20 years in the future? And if so, which ones really stand out for you?
Gosh, in the last 20 years, I've heard a lot of great music. I like, you know, as far as like alternative music, you know, that era, I like Pavement. You know, Pavement's really good. MIA for like new music.
Yeah, for sure.
Exciting. And oh my gosh, where do I start? You know?
Just say In Utero, just the third record.
Oh yeah, In Utero, yeah.
Okay, definitely. All right, great. Thank you so much for your time,
Foo
Chris.
Foo Fighters.
Oh, yeah, there you go, yes. There it is. You're required to say that, I believe. Thank you so much, sir. We really appreciate it. Lovely talking to you, and all the best.
Hey, and so long to folks, Triple J listeners, Australia, and my pleasure.